everyone, and welcome back to DWG TV. I'm Hannah, and today I'm joined by Parker Moore, who is the CEO and co-founder of Tux on Trux. And today we're really going to be talking about how to find your niche market and how identifying a pain point in your industry and really coming up with a unique solution for that can give your business a serious competitive advantage. So without further ado, we'll get into it. Thanks for being here, Parker.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So for those who might be unfamiliar, what is Tux on Trux?
Well, Tux on Trux, just as the name kind of suggests, is a mobile tuxedo rental service that primarily serves high school proms, college formals, and occasionally a wedding here or there. And what makes us most unique, I think, is that we're actually going to the customer at their facility. So for high schools, for example, we're going to set up in that school. We partner with the school, mm-hmm. and we kind of make a prom, for this case, even more of a school event, and having all the touch point with our customers is actually at the school.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the business model, kind mm-hmm. of the idea behind what we're doing. We've been at it for about 4 years now.
Awesome. So how did you come up with this idea?
Well, I experienced the pain point, as you just kind of threw out there in the intro, and the issue of this industry. Tuxedos haven't changed, of course, in hundreds of years, the actual look. Mm-hmm. And the industry hasn't really changed much either. And in high school, I was getting ready for prom, and I went to a really small school, well, small town, large school, but mm-hmm. I had to drive about 30 minutes into the next biggest city to find a men's warehouse, in this mm-hmm. case. Well, after you're making three trips back and forth to the store, you're basically spending about 2 hours, and I realized I didn't even wear the tuxedo for 2 hours.
Yeah, that's so true.
And I spent way too much money on this tuxedo, and I thought, why can't we have a tuxedo rental company come to the school and fit us, just like we have class rings and mm-hmm. School pictures and all these school kind of events take place in the building.
Yeah.
And the idea hit me, the name hit me mm-hmm. all at once, even the slogan of all things. And I didn't do anything with this though until college here at the University of South Carolina, where I had a class where you had to create a little business.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was the lazy junior college student, and I thought, well, why don't I just recycle this old business idea that I had in high school, we'll use it for this class project. So it all kind of started by accident. I did the class project, and I had a professor encourage us to go pitch it mm-hmm. at an entrepreneurship competition. We did pretty well at mm-hmm. that, and it caught some local press here, and we actually had our first customer, our first client, if you will, before we even had a supplier. So they were like, we'll have you at our high school, Irmo High School, which you went to Irmo High School.
Yep, I went to Irmo.
So Irmo was like, well, cool, let's just have you on board. And we're like, well, we got to go find suppliers first. So it all kind of started by accident from this idea I had in high school.
Cool. So what was the process like for bringing this idea to life? I know you said you pitched it and came up with the idea in your class. Like, what events unfolded to bring this to life?
Sure. Well, when we first pitched it, it was a very different, it was the same kind of concept, but different avenue to get to that goal, meaning that we kind of envisioned the company to literally be a truck and like this massive 18-wheeler, and it would show up at the school, and all fittings and deliveries would take place out of this truck,
mm-hmm.
and very high upfront cost.
Yep.
And we realized that, one, we don't have the money. Two, we don't really want to spend a month or two pitching around for money for mm-hmm. some concept that is definitely unique. So we decided that, why don't we just ask the school if we can just come in the door?
Mm-hmm.
And what we learned was that not only are they letting us come in the schools, they're actually helping us promote the company and do a lot of the marketing for us. Because
mm-hmm.
it's high school level, you got to reach the kid, who's mm-hmm. the user, and then the parent, who of course is the buyer.
Right.
And those are very different people.
Mm, absolutely.
And so it's tough to get home to mom and dad without the school's help.
Yeah.
And so we've been fortunate to have the schools kind of buy in on that. And so we kind of started with just that one high school,
mm-hmm.
and then word of mouth spread, and we kind of adapted our business model a little bit to meet the need of every school.
Mm-hmm.
And today we've morphed into this online presence where we can also do self-fitting algorithm tools that we have, where some guy could find us in Texas and he can order from us and we can ship that out there to him. Where in the past it was like, well, we need to see you in person.
Yeah.
So it's changed a little bit mm-hmm. over the 3.5-4 years we've been doing this. Mm-hmm. Changed for the better, I think.
Yeah.
But you've got to be willing to adapt and
absolutely
and, you can grow in that way.
Right.
Yeah.
So what sets Tux on Trux, I know you hit on this a little bit, what sets them apart from competitors like those big box stores like Men's Warehouse, for example?
Well, it's fascinating, this industry. I mean, I didn't come into it with some sort of fashion background or anything like that, clearly. But I kind of studied it a little bit early on, and I saw a lot of these big box stores are actually closing down, and they're going more toward online. But that, you know, we're able to, what makes us kind of better is obviously our from a business standpoint, we have very low cost. Yeah. We don't have to keep the lights on. We don't have to really pay all these people. Mm-hmm. Property taxes, you can name the list.
Yeah.
On top of that, though, really the big selling point for us is the sheer convenience, mm-hmm. especially the high school crowd where the parents are very much involved in finding that tuxedo for Jimmy. But the college crowd, they see the convenience in a whole different light. They still see it, but it's like, hey, I can just, because some of them are renting 3 or 4 times a spring. Because they're going to their formal, their date's formal, their formal's formal. And so they see it convenient as well for...
airplane?
An airplane coming in. For just how many times they're renting every year.
Yeah.
And so once we have their sizes, it's just a one-click order for them.
Yeah, that's so
and,
nice.
And it just shows up right at their fraternity house or their dorm room here at USC. So... convenience, I'd say, is the short answer to that question, and certainly price. We're about $25 to $30 cheaper compared to the exact same tux you're going to find at Men's Warehouse, for example.
For a college student, that's huge.
Huge. And by the way, Men's Warehouse, they own about everybody else. Joseph A. Bank, it's all the same company. Mm-hmm. David's Bridal, they're the same crew. And so they are all kind of in this same boat where they've taken on a lot of upfront costs in all these stores. And now you're starting to see some store closures and a little bit more of a drift toward online sales. Hopefully we're on the right path for that.
Yeah, sounds like it. So what kind of response have you heard from your customers, and what's making them choose Tux on Trux over those big box stores?
Well, a little bit of that convenience.
Yeah.
Just there's this kind of cool aspect to it as well that we're also battling, I think, with this tradition of, you know, when you would think tuxedo rental, you kind of picture yourself in a store,
right?
For years and years, that's just how we did it. So we just did, for example, we just did a fraternity here at USC about 2 weeks ago, and we fit the entire fraternity at the fraternity house. And that was a cool experience for them because they're at the fraternity house literally all the time. And now they're just able to swing by on a Monday night from 6 to 8. And it takes 2 seconds to get fitted. And, you know, we're back there before formal unloading the tuxedos and people can pick them up. And so it was extremely convenient. It was done in a place they're familiar with. And then they're asking questions like, wait a minute, this is actually... They start to see the process and they go, well, I got a formal in 2 weeks. Can I just keep this tux? I'm like, no, we'll do it better. We'll give you a fresh one in 2 weeks from now, you know. It's just this new tradition, and once we have a customer use us, they will use us again, whether it's for another formal or for prom to formal. I have that's happened too. We've had high school students at they'll go to college and they'll ask us, are we at College of Charleston? And we're like, yeah, we are. Why don't you use us there too? And then they're going to be in someone's wedding, or if they're not, their own wedding. And so there's this new tradition we're trying to set with how people think about getting ready for a formal event.
Right. Yeah, and you're really just building that lifetime value with your users, with your customers. And it sounds like with your business model, you just really know your personas and know what their pain points are, what they're looking for. That convenience matters to them. It's more personalized experience.
Right.
You're providing the service to them in a place where they're already comfortable. So
Exactly. And weddings is a little different crowd. We haven't talked too much about them, but weddings a little bit more case-by-case basis, obviously.
Right.
And smaller groups, of course, 8-9 people tops in some cases. So we are, for the wedding side of this, we're really going the extra mile to make sure it's a really personal experience, whether we're doing fittings at the bachelor party, you know, something, or just at someone's house.
Yeah.
So, really cool.
Awesome. So how has online marketing played into your success?
Yeah, it's, you know, in the first couple seasons of this, it's been very shoestring budget. You know, we really just through very little money at some Facebook ads. You know, that was about as fancy as we got.
Yeah.
We saw some okay returns from that, but we really weren't experts in that. And sure. So this coming this season that we're in now,
mm-hmm.
We have done a whole lot more research with, you know, who exactly is our customer?
Mm-hmm.
Where are they living online?
Mm-hmm.
Where can we best reach them at certain times of day?
Mm-hmm.
That's huge. And so we've been able to spend more money on this. So we've seen some incredible returns already. I know it's early in the year right now, but
mm-hmm.
I've been very impressed with just Google Analytics and Google AdWords space. What key phrases, what keywords
Absolutely.
Are most searched? You know, oddly, it's Tux. I didn't think that Tux would hit that much, but
mm-hmm.
I thought Tuxedo Rentals or something. But just
sure.
three letters, TUX, has incredible results. And so learning things like that,
yeah.
kind of in the digital space,
mm-hmm.
I studied a little bit of that in college, as you know, but I never had to put it into practice until this season.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's fun, it will be fun at the end of this season to see, okay, well, how successful were we
mm-hmm.
on the digital front?
Yeah.
So it's new for us this season, mm-hmm. but as of now, it's pleasantly surprising
yeah.
How well it's working.
Yeah, keyword research is huge, and
huge.
It's something that you're continually learning and working on.
Right.
So I'm really excited to see what kind of results y'all get from
yeah.
digging into that some more.
I think one of the best things our company has for us is the name.
Yeah, it's a really cool name.
Tux on Trux, even the spelling of TRUX, Trux.
Sure.
A little unique there,
mm-hmm.
But sometimes that uniqueness helps because once people see the logo, they kind of remember it. And there's no really questioning what this company does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of companies are like, what exactly do y'all do?
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have to kind of tell our story very
exactly.
often. It's just kind of immediate, hit you over the head.
Yeah.
And that works really well with some short Instagram kind of videos and
sure.
things like that.
Absolutely. So you touched on this in the beginning, but can you kind of touch on how this business has evolved from its beginnings, like where you started as to where you are now?
Yeah, it's changed a bit. You know, to give you some specifics, I guess, we've had a really tough time in the beginning finding a supplier.
Mm.
A lot of suppliers in this industry, very old school, and they want to make sure you have a retail store. And like, well, no, sir, we're not going to give an account to you if you're like everywhere.
Yeah.
And we're like, well, but they just couldn't buy into the vision.
Mm-hmm.
And so we found one supplier who worked with us in some ways, and then we found that we're doing so well that we're actually hurting their other accounts who do have retail stores.
Hmm.
It's like, well, sir, you can't go to Clemson because we've got accounts there that we're also servicing, and we're afraid you might upset them. And I'm like, well, it's kind of their problem, you know, isn't it? You know, I mean,
yeah.
If the customer's choosing us, that's a sign that the retail store is not working.
Right.
And the supplier shouldn't care because they're getting business regardless. So
mm-hmm.
anyway, we've over the past, you know, 3 years or so, we've had to really study the supply chain side of this and make sure that our partners on that side of the business, which is the business,
mm-hmm.
Can really, A, buy into our grand vision of this, which
mm-hmm.
is more of a franchise model years from now,
mm-hmm.
and then B, have the scalability and the warehouse and the shipping logistics kind of straightened out to where we can drop ship a Tux to anybody's front door in the country within 2 days, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'll pay extra if we have to get it there in a day,
yeah.
you know? And so we've got that right partner. We just signed that agreement at the beginning of this year, and that's something that we had to really change the mindset of and kind of adjust
mm-hmm.
and how we operate a little bit there.
Sure.
On top of that, we're also partnering with, very excited to kind of announce, we're partnering with Jostens, which is really the exact business model we try to mimic.
Right.
But just for the tuxedo industry.
Mm-hmm.
So to have Jostens on board with us in the South Carolina area, over 50-something high schools that we're going to be kind of working with them in, that name recognition, that kind
sure.
of familiarity. If that's it.
Familiar. It's a tough one.
Yes.
There
it's
you go.
Familiar
we got you.
to the parents, which is the key there.
Yeah.
Because those parents used Jostens when they were in high school. And so having
yeah.
that name brand associated with us
mm-hmm.
is everything
yeah
to me at least. So we've just been more mindful this season than years past of, you know, what do we want to be like, how do we get very close to them,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And whether they're in our space or not, you know, even for example, I'm excited about this, prom is such a huge industry in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
Tuxedo is just the beginning. Limousine rentals, florists, photographers.
Yeah.
If you can pull a lot of these people in and say, hey, I've got, you know, this entire high school looking at my tuxedo catalog, why don't we offer your photography session with this tuxedo for a package deal of, you know, $219 or
right.
whatever. So we're seeing other industry players come into this as well, and that's really exciting.
Yeah, and it's just overall streamlining that process for your user.
Yes.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
It's very smart.
We want to make it a one-stop shop
yeah.
experience, and that kind of a new tradition year after year. Just like Jostens, you expect
yeah.
them to show up
exactly.
and do class rings every spring. You expect there to be a yearbook. You don't even think twice about it.
Yeah.
But those are outside vendors coming into your school, mm-hmm. and that's what we want to be too.
Awesome. So what's next for your business? I know you have the partnership with Jostens. What is your vision moving forward?
Well, short term, you know, we want to make sure that we're hitting great numbers at our schools this year, but also establishing great relationships in those schools so we're there next year. That's what it's about.
Yeah.
We also are, for the first time this season, we're able to do all the tuxedos, hopefully for College of Charleston
wow.
and their graduation,
yeah.
Because they wear white dinner jackets for that, so that's mm-hmm. huge. And so that's kind of on the front end of the calendar.
Yeah.
But I think long term, our goal for this is to really do a franchise model I mentioned earlier, where we really kill it in one geographic area,
mm-hmm.
and then you know build this. Kind of Bible of how to run Trux on Trux, sell it to some guy in Jacksonville and say,
mm-hmm.
hey, you can do this in Florida and you can do this in Chapel Hill and here's how it works in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're going to sell these little, you know, Trux on Trux opportunities across the country is the ultimate goal. And then that I think that is where we'll see a big impact and hopefully a complete change of
mm-hmm.
the tuxedo industry and bringing it more to the schools and in person.
Very cool.
Yeah.
And it all started with just an idea and a class during college.
Yeah, it's all an idea in college. And
now you're here.
Now I'm here, and it feels kind of crazy.
Yeah.
But I think it's just, I was very shy in high school, very shy in college, believe it or not. And so I never thought I would stand up in front of people and pitch an idea.
Yeah.
So it is kind of strange.
Yeah. It's crazy how what you think you're going to do when you're in high school or college kind of evolves. I mean, I'm sure you never
no.
anticipated being in this kind of industry.
No, never.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's awesome. So what advice would you give to someone who has a business idea but doesn't know really where to start?
Yeah.
Clearly you've been really successful with kind of nailing down, all right, this is my audience's pain point. This is this unique solution that we can come up with that streamlines this experience for them. If someone has an idea for a business, how can they kind of implement best practices of what you've learned to bring their idea to life?
I think for every person it's a little different.
Sure.
Of course, the business idea should be different.
Yeah.
But I try to get out and speak to some classes at USC. I'm doing that later today, actually. And I find the saddest thing I hear is that people have business ideas. They'll raise their hand, oh, I've got an idea. And I'm like, okay, tell us about it.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole mood changes.
Mm.
Well, they're too shy to talk about it.
Yeah.
Or what's worse, I'll find that people don't want to talk about it.
Mm.
And I kind of look back at myself and I'm like, you know, I was like that at one point
yeah.
where I had this really cool idea in my own head and I was too afraid to tell you about it because you might steal it.
Mm, yeah.
And I'm like, well, you gotta get out there and talk about it.
Yeah.
If you don't, even like co-working spaces like this, very important.
Yeah.
And early on, even with this idea and other random ideas, that was kind of my mindset, where it was like, well, let's just keep everything to myself and in-house, and you're not going to be able to grow, you're not going to be able to learn what's best for the customer,
mm-hmm.
You're not going to be able to make those adaptive changes
yeah.
about your business model and how it's structured, and you can't be too married to the company. Right.
Yeah.
You have to love what the idea of the company
mm-hmm.
and what you want it to do,
mm-hmm.
but the actual action steps of how to actually get that done, if you're stuck in your ways, it's not going to work.
Sure.
And so I see that too often with
yeah.
people who have business ideas. They're too afraid or they're just rebellious of sharing that idea, and that's tragic. So I guess that's my advice.
Yeah.
Is,
good advice.
Chat.
Yeah.
Talk. and put yourself an opportunity, put yourself situations to give you opportunities.
Yeah.
We've certainly had doors open just because I handed somebody a business card.
Yeah.
You know,
exactly.
An Uber driver, literally. Yeah. Handing them a business card, and now I've got a wedding in May that we're
exactly.
serviced.
So yep, you never know.
You never know. Yep. Yeah, it's really cool.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So where can people go to find more information about Tux on Trux and learn more about y'all?
Sure, yeah. I mean, tuxontrux.com, our website, that's truxtrux.com. Mm-hmm. And, join us for this incredible season that we're doing, and you can rent a Tux on the website if you need one.
Awesome. For whatever life event you have.
That's right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. We can do it.
Very cool. Well, thanks so much for joining us today.
Yeah, my
pleasure. It's a great conversation. So I hope y'all found value in this, and I know I really enjoyed chatting with Parker today. So if you enjoyed this, please like and share this video and connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram. We're on all the platforms, so give us a like, give us a follow, and connect with us there so you can find out when we'll be going live next and other updates of that nature. And speaking of when we'll be going live next, we'll be back on April 16th at 1 p.m. Eastern time to talk with Casey Banks. She's the Director of Communications at 1000 Feathers, and we're going to be talking about understanding your digital footprint. So that's going to be a good one. Be sure to mark your calendars for that. And with that being said, that's about all we have for you today. Thanks again, Parker.
Thank you.
And we'll see y'all next time. Bye.